Hey folks, my name is Hunor, and in this mini course, I'm going to explain how to create a snake game with HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. It's a mini course because I'm not going to explain everything. We are not going through the code line by line, and we won't code along. I'm going to give you a quick overview of how the game is built up and explain some of the tricky parts, and then you can look up the rest in the source code. You can find the whole game on CodePen, so if you want to try it out and see what we are getting into, check out the link in the description below. You can play the game, and there you can see the whole source code. There's plenty of comments in the source code, so this quick introduction should be enough for you to get you started. In this video, I'm going through the main parts, but I won't cover the fading effect this game has on CodePen. We're only gonna cover a regular snake game, then we're going through how the transitioning effect works from one tile to another. For this project, I'm not using any libraries, not even SVG or Canvas, just plain HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Of course, it could have been made with some more advanced tools, especially with Canvas, the animation might be smoother, but it works pretty well this way as well. Also, if you're interested in using Canvas, in my next mini course, I'll explain a game that uses Canvas, so click subscribe if you don't want to miss that. Let's see the layout first. The layout is a 50x50 grid, but instead of positioning them individually, we have 225 tiles as div elements in a list, then we make it look like a grid with CSS grid. Because of this, we will need a few calculations later on when the snake is moving and we need to figure out which tile is above or below a tile, but it's not too complicated. Also, this is just an example. I'm not actually having 225 hard-coded tiles in HTML, I'm generating them with JavaScript. You can find a source code for that on CodePen. So how do we render the snake and the fruit on the field? With this setup, we can have an array for the snake positions and a value for the apple or the fruit position. I'm not sure if snakes actually eat apples, but I'm calling it apple in this code. So then we can simply access the tile corresponding for the positions and just change their CSS to set a background color for a snake part or to change the background and add the border radius for the foot tile. And that's it. If you just want to paint a static scene, it's fairly simple. But with a real game, with a lot of moving parts, it's a bit more complicated. Let's see how the whole game works. The game has four main parts and functions. There's a main loop that keeps track of time and decides if the snake should take another step forward. There's a step function that repaints the layout after the snake took a step. It will use a next position utility function that determines to which tile the snake moves next based on the current direction and the user inputs. And finally, in parallel with all this, we also handle user interaction to change the snake's direction. Let's start with handling user input because that's the most simple one. We register an event listener to the key down event, and then if one of the arrow keys is pressed, then first we prevent the default action because otherwise the browser might think that we try to scroll the page, then change the direction. Here we push a new direction into an array. And this is an array because we want to enable quick turns when the player is pressing keys faster than the snake moves. Like when the snake moves to the right and the player wants to have a quick turn back and presses up, then left right after each other, and the snake haven't even moved up a tile yet, but we already know that once the snake moved upwards, it needs to turn left. So we have a stack of future turns here. In this function, we could also make some fine-tuning, like we can ignore full turns. Like for instance, if the snake is going right and we press the left, then we could ignore that. Same for duplicates. If you press right, but the snake is already going right, then we can ignore that as well. This all depends on how you make the game rules. If you are going to create your own snake game, then you can decide how to implement your version. Now let's get to the main event loop. This is using request animation frame, so it will run 60 times every second. The request animation frame gives a timestamp that you can use to calculate the time elapsed since the beginning of the game. This timer, of course, will always reset when we start the game. We also keep track here how many steps did the snake take. And based on the time passed and the snake's speed, we can also figure out if it's time for the snake to take a step forward. Then we got to the step function, which is fairly simple at this phase. We just got the next position from the getNextPosition function, add it to the snake positions array, and paint the corresponding tile to black. Then also we clear up the tail of the snake, except if the snake just reached the food, because then the snake is growing and the tail remains. So how do we get the position? First we figure out the direction. It's either the next item in the user inputs array, or we just go to the same direction the snake is already going. Then we figure out the index of the next tile. If the snake moves to the right, then we just add +1 to the current head position. If the snake moves to the left, then it's the same thing in the opposite direction, we subtract 1. If we want to go downwards, this is a bit trickier. We have to add the number of items in a row to the current head position to get the index of the tile below the head. This is 15 in our case because the width of the grid is 15. If we go up, then the same story backwards. We subtract 15 from the current head position. Of course, we also need to do some hit detection in this function to make sure that the snake does not hit the wall or doesn't bite itself. In these cases, we just throw an error with a message, and in the main event loop, you might have noticed there's a try-catch block that will catch this error and show a note to the user. After an error, the game loop stops, so we have to restart it for a new game. You can see it on this slide, but if you check the actual source code, you're going to see that the game restarts with the space key. In a happier scenario, we can also run into some food. In this case, we increase our score variable, show it to the player by setting the corresponding HTML element's content, and we generate a new apple. So that's the base game. It's very simple, but it does the job. But of course, instead of stepping tile by tile, it would be much nicer to have a smooth transitioning from one tile to another. To achieve this, we can have a modified HTML structure. We are going to have a content div for each tile that will take an absolute position relative to the tile itself. This is great because now instead of filling the wall tile, we can just fill part of it and we can set from which direction should the field start. Here you can see an example of the idea, but of course we are not setting this from CSS. But we are setting this dynamically from JavaScript based on the snake's direction. If the snake is heading to the right, then we start the content from the left and set a width appropriate to the progress of transitioning. Like if the snake is halfway between two steps, then we can set the width of the content to 50% of the tile. If the snake is heading to the left, then the same thing is happening, except the snake moves in from the other direction from the right. If the snake is moving down, then we position the content to the top, and this time instead of setting the content width relative to the tile, we set the content height according to the progress. If the snake is moving up, the same thing except we position the content to the bottom. The inner parts of the snake, the tiles except for the head and the tail, don't need any positioning. We can just set the background color and let it fill the tile. So with this method, we can achieve a smooth transitioning. But we are missing one piece from the code. If the snake keeps moving and starts changing directions, we will need to change the absolute positioning in CSS. And in that case, it's better to reset the values set before. Like when the snake was transitioning horizontally, we changed the width attribute, but then it turns upwards, we better clear the width attribute and reset it to 100%. To solve this problem, I use a setTile function that sets the values according to its input, but resets every other CSS attribute that we don't set specifically. One last thing to mention. If you check out the actual source code for the game, which you can find, of course, in the links below, then you will find that I did some optimization regarding which parts of the grid are repainted. It doesn't repaint the wall grid every time, because that would be quite resource heavy. It doesn't even repaint the wall snake. When the snake transitions between two tiles, the body of the snake stays intact and only the head and the tail are transitioning. That's why you won't find a simple step function, but you find a step and transition function along with the transition function. As the name suggests, the step and transition function takes care of moving from one tile to another and sets up the CSS attributes for the transition function. On the other hand, the transition function just eases the head and tail in between two steps. The reason for this is that the transition function is called with every render, so it has to be fast. And the step and transition function can be a bit slower because that only happens at every step. So those were the main parts of this game. If you want to dig deeper into the code, you can find the whole game with its source code in the description below. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you liked it, please subscribe. I'm planning to do some of these in a similar fashion. In the next one, we are going through a game also built with JavaScript, which we will use Canvas. So hope to see you there.